Thank you.
The next item of business is a statement by Michael Matheson on Climate Change Committee's review of Scottish emissions targets and progress report 2022. The Cabinet Secretary will take questions at the end of his statement, and so there should be no interventions or interruptions. I call on Cabinet Secretary Michael Matheson around 10 minutes, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and I thank the Climate Change Committee for the two documents published on the 7th of December, their latest annual Scottish Progress Report and their first five-yearly review of Scotland's emissions targets set by Parliament in the 2019 Scottish Climate Change Act. The reports recognise many areas of progress and welcome Scotland's extraordinary ambition with regards to climate change. However, we cannot ignore the fact that elements of the committee's advice make for difficult reading. It is evident that we are entering a very challenging chapter on our journey to net zero, with deep cuts to our emissions required over the course of this decade. We are committed to rising to that challenge and ending Scotland's contribution to climate change by 2045. This chamber is aware of the scale and urgency of the climate emergency. That was why the Scottish Parliament quite rightly passed extremely ambitious targets for Scotland to reduce emissions by 75% by 2030, going beyond the target levels proposed by the Climate Change Committee, and to reach net zero by 2045. Today, we are over halfway to net zero. There is a record that we should take pride in, especially as we continue to be ahead of the UK as a whole in delivering long-term emission reductions. We must, however, be prepared for the possibility that the 2021 emission statistics show a rebound when reported next June, as a consequence of COVID restrictions being lifted during 2021, while significant sources of peatland emissions will be brought within scope for the first time when next year's target reporting uses the most up-to-date set of inventory methods. As recognised by the Climate Change Committee, this will bring significant challenge for meeting already ambitious statutory targets through the 2020s. The emissions cut required to meet future targets will involve genuinely transformative decisions for Scotland, with significant long-term investment, demand management and behaviour change required. Similar decisions are currently being faced across the world. It is our responsibility to help Scotland make that transition and to continue to demonstrate our well-respected global reputation for action on climate change. The transition to net zero is not just an environmental imperative, but also an economic opportunity. We have seen great success in our renewable sector. ScotWind, for example, represents the world's largest commercial round for floating offshore wind. And yesterday, we published our final onshore wind policy statement, setting out our ambition to deploy 20 gigawatts of onshore wind by 2030. These successes need to be replicated in other sectors as we harness the opportunity that the transition will bring to Scotland. And in January, we will publish our energy strategy, Just Transition Plan, and a renewables sector export plan. President Officer, we agree with the Climate Change Committee that cooperation with the UK Government is key to realising both Scotland's ambitions and the full potential of Scotland's contribution to the UK's own decarbonisation plans. Given the significant powers reserved to Westminster, including on energy infrastructure, taxation and borrowing powers, Scottish ministers will continue to discuss further with UK government ministers how we can ensure our plans can progress at the speed that we all require them to progress at. Turning back to the report, the CCC have highlighted areas where we are making significant progress but clearly need to go further including on buildings, peatland restoration and on transport. I'm pleased that the CCC recognises Scotland's ambition to decarbonise buildings much faster than the UK as a whole, as well as our substantial funding commitment and progress on enabling measures. Heating our homes and workplaces causes 20% of Scotland's emissions. We won't achieve our net zero target without ending our use of gas boilers. Therefore, we are stepping up our investment in accelerating deployment of heat and energy efficiency measures and to support those least able to pay, allocating at least £1.8 billion over the course of this Parliament. This funding is supporting a range of alternatives to fossil fuel heating, such as heat pumps, and measures to install better insulation, making homes easier and more affordable to heat, especially for those who need that help the most. It will also support investment in heat networks and in making sure that all of our public sector buildings can also move to zero emission heat. We will consult next year on a Heating Buildings Bill, which will require all homes and buildings across Scotland to use net zero emission heating systems by 2045. And next year, we also see the launch of our public engagement strategy, making people aware of what we are proposing to do, why it matters so much, and what this will mean in practice. Senior Officer, on transport, our second strategic transport projects review, published just 2 weeks ago, confirms that the era of catering for unconstrained growth in private car use is well and truly over. The review follows the sustainable investment hierarchy, which aims to reduce the need to travel unsustainably and prioritises making best use of enhancing existing infrastructure before investing in new capacity. Furthermore, we have set out how we will reduce car kilometres by 20% by 2030 in our draft route map, a truly world-leading commitment demonstrating our level of ambition in meeting Scotland's statutory targets. The Scottish Government have commissioned research exploring demand management options to discourage car use, and using the research findings, we will work with local and regional partners to develop a demand management framework by 2025. We've also committed to fully decarbonising passenger rail services in Scotland by 2035, pledged at least £320 million a year by 2024-25 on active travel infrastructure, access to bikes and behaviour change, awarded £25 million of bus priority funding to 11 partnerships covering 28 local authorities, and awarded £28 million of funding over the next 4 years to support innovation to decarbonise heavy vehicles, including battery and hydrogen technologies. On peatland, we have committed some £250 million to restoring 250,000 hectares of degraded peatland by 2030, including £26 million for the next financial year. Through supporting good green jobs in the rural economy, this investment will also play a part in Scotland's just transition to net zero by 2045. We've delivered around 57,000 hectares of restored peatland to date. This is good progress, but we know we must go much further. We are working hard with delivery partners to tackle the barriers to upscaling peatland restoration. Our delivery forecast for this year estimates that we will achieve a 65% increase in peatland restoration rates from last year. Senior Officer, lastly, on the Climate Change Committee's targets advice, the Climate Change Committee have suggested that the annual targets throughout the 2020s should be changed for technical reasons to align with the revised greenhouse gas inventory. I can advise the Chamber today that we will consider this advice in the round and we will respond to it as soon as possible. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, we are making good, steady progress in what will be a very difficult journey, and we welcome the advice from the Climate Change Committee helping us along that journey. As part of our continuous review of policy, we will be working closely with the Climate Change Committee to ensure we benefit fully from their expertise while progressing delivery and considering possible new actions. The Climate Change Committee's advice will also support development of the next Climate Change Plan, which we have committed to publish in draft no later than November 2023. Scottish Ministers, Presiding Officer, will now take the opportunity, the appropriate time, to consider the recommendations within the CCC's advice, and we will respond in the spring of next year.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. The Cabinet Secretary will now take questions on the issues raised in his statement. I intend to allow around 20 minutes for questions, after which we will move on to the next item of business. It would be helpful if members who wish to ask a question were to press the request to speak buttons now, and I call on Liam Kerr.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I thank the Cabinet Secretary for advance sight of his statement, but I'm struggling to understand how, in the context of such a damning report, highlighting 7 out of 11 emissions targets missed, car use increasing, minimal progress reducing agriculture emissions and abject failures on peatland restoration and tree planting, he nonetheless delivers a statement of such breathtaking complacency that he suggests that is a record we should take pride in and we are making good progress on what will be a very difficult journey. He talks of extremely ambitious targets, but the committee said it is currently very difficult to monitor progress against the necessary measures due to a lack of adequate and up-to-date data. And when I asked about exactly this last week, the Cabinet Secretary opened his response with, "I will set out the process that is already in place." Cabinet Secretary, the Climate Change Committee is clear. What is in place has failed. So, first of all, Cabinet Secretary, what has been done since the committee's report to ensure proper data collection, to collate the baseline data and measure progress on our journey to net zero? And on decarbonising buildings, the Cabinet Secretary says we are stepping up our investment, and then in the next breath says he's allocating at least £1.8 billion over the course of this Parliament, a figure that was first announced about 18 months ago and way below the more than £33 billion that is required. Now, Lord Deben said that the committee wants to see the programme of how the SNP government is going to deliver this decarbonisation of heat. So, Cabinet Secretary, when will the SNP government produce a detailed plan on decarbonising buildings, including how it intends to address this funding gap?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, Presiding Officer, I don't know if the member was listening to the response I gave in the urgent question or my statement where I accept the criticisms and the challenges set out in this report. But equally, I'm sure the member would also want to recognise that the report acknowledges the progress that has been made. You could be forgiven for listening to Liam Kerr and thinking that no progress had been made, but the reality is that we are already over halfway there to achieving net zero, but we need to do much more and drive forward delivery much more effectively. That's a reality, that's the stats, that's the data that is out there right now that the member was making reference to and calling for more of. So that's where we are in this particular journey. I mean, he talks about criticism of government. He will be aware of the very significant report they issued on the UK government offering very similar criticism on the lack of progress which they have been making, which is why governments across the whole of the UK need to take more concerted action to address these matters. And issues such as, he mentioned, peatland restoration. For example, there have been challenges in scaling up the level of peatland restoration that we need to achieve. The target is to restore some 250,000 hectares of peatland between now and 2030. We have already achieved some 57,000 hectares. That is progress, but we need to go further. Part of the challenge in doing some of that has been the scaling up of the industry in order to undertake that work because of limitations to that. And as I've mentioned, we're already starting to see the progress that that's happening with the uplift we've saw in peatland restoration this year. And on the issue of hidden buildings, which is a critical area, we've already set out their intention to bring forward primary legislation, not to put in statute the requirement to speed up the deployment of the decarbonisation of homes, in order to make sure that we're driving forward that agenda going forward. So I want to assure the member that the final point I want to make here is that in setting out the programme, as I also stated in the response and urgent question, is in our climate change plan update, which we published this year, we will set out in much greater detail the link between policy choices and impact and the data which underpins that, in order to provide the CCC with the transparency that they are looking for in order to demonstrate the progress that we're making in key policy areas, both in terms of delivering climate change, but also in the economic opportunities that go with that and the cost which is associated with it.
Colin Smith.
Thank you, President Officer, and thank you to the Cabinet Secretary for advance sight of his statement. But listening to the Cabinet Secretary, you really would be forgiven for thinking this isn't an utterly scathing review from the Climate Change Committee on the Government's failure, but it absolutely is, and he's clearly in denial. 7 out of 11 of our increasingly at-risk legal targets are missed. Targets, the committee say, are in danger of becoming meaningless. Progress on cutting emissions, they say, has largely stalled. On the three big emitters, transport, heat and buildings, land use, this report card is a clear fail. Fail, fail. A year ago, the chairman of the Climate Change Committee, Lord Devon, called for more clarity and transparency on Scottish climate policy and delivery. Cabinet Secretary, why did that plea, in the words of Lord Devon, go unanswered? Now, the Cabinet Secretary said there will be another draft plan along soon, November next year. But we had a so-called plan in 2018. We had another plan in 2020. And the Climate Change Committee still say there's no clear delivery plan, no coherent explanation, no clue how Scotland will get to net zero. So, Cabinet Secretary, does he think they're right? And what specifically will he do differently in next year's plan to make sure it is third time lucky, or will we be back here next year debating how much further Scotland is falling behind meeting our climate targets?
Cabinet Secretary.
So, in a number of these key areas, we're already starting to make progress. So let me take, for example, on issues around transport. We've already set out the plan that we have to take forward in order to reduce car kilometres by 20%. I hope that, given that the member is such an enthusiastic supporter of the targets which the CCC have set, that he'll be supporting policies that will deliver these outcomes. When it comes to, as we often find, when it comes to these policy matters, is that opposition members like to set targets, but they're very short when it comes to being able to detail the policy actions that should be implemented to deliver them. Or when they are brought forward and they think they're a bit controversial, they back off them. A bit like a support when it came to the parking charges issues as well, which you didn't want to give powers to councils on.
Cabinet Secretary, please resume your seat for a second. Mr Smith, I appreciate you asked a number of questions, actually, in your slot, and it would be helpful if we could all hear what the Cabinet Secretary, how the Cabinet Secretary responds to that, and therefore, including from the member who posed the question, that might be a good thing to do. Cabinet Secretary.
I'm sure he would like to hear these answers, and also the challenge to him in being able to, or the member, to stepping up to actually showing some leadership in the policies he thinks it should be pursued, which is, as has been for years, has been missing for some time. And the member says from a central position, what you do about buses? Well, we're now in a point in Scotland where there's actually 2.3 million people travel on buses for free. Yeah. Almost half the population, because of the actions we have taken, now travel on buses for free. No other part of the UK provides that, including Labour-led Wales, when it comes to it as well. But what I can assure the member is that if we take forward the... And I've invited the member to actually join the group that will be responsible for helping to shape the future climate change plan, including members from across this chamber, in order to help them to influence what the policy options should be in going forward, so that we can also make sure the data is there and that we can set out very clearly what that pathway is going to be in the next climate change plan. And the reason I'm inviting these members, Presiding Officer, is because it is fine for Parliament to set targets, which I think is the right thing to do, but we also have a collective responsibility, as the Committee on Climate Change Chair points out, to also set out the policy options that will deliver on these targets. And I hope that members who have invited to that group will join me in helping to shape that policy and that policy programme in the next climate change plan.
I call Fiona Hislop to be followed by Edward Mountain.
On Tuesday, Lord Eben, Chair of the UK Climate Change Committee, told this Parliament's Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee that in Scotland there was not sufficient partnership between the Scottish Government and local government, and a better planning and coordination relationship was needed to deliver on the net zero targets, which, I'll remind people, were set by all parties in this Parliament. He also referenced Wales as an example to look at. Will the Cabinet Secretary do so, but also commit to give serious consideration to the soon-to-be-published Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee's inquiry report into the role for local government and its partners in delivering net zero?
Cabinet Secretary.
Senior Officer, in relation to the final point the member made with regards to the committee's report, of course I'll be more than happy to consider that report, which I would do as a matter of course, and I've got no doubt that it will be very useful in helping to shape some of the actions and measures that we need to take forward in order to help to grow and develop our partnership with local authorities. We are presently undertaking work with COSLA and improvement services and local authorities to identify what further measures we can take to support them and be able to develop their climate change plans and how they can be implemented at a local level, because there's no doubt that our local authority partners have a key role to play in helping to meet our climate change targets. I'm keen to make sure that we build on that, and where there is good practice, whether it be in Wales, Scotland, Northern Ireland or anywhere else that we can learn from in helping to shape that, I'm very keen to make sure that we utilise that. So the suggestion that's been made by the member on the report, and where there is good practice, we will certainly look to address those issues, but equally to assure of the actions that we are already taking in order to improve the partnership between national government and our colleagues within local government to deliver on climate change plans at a local level.
I call Edward Mountain to be followed by Jackie Dunbar.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I would like to make a declaration that I'm part of a family farming partnership and I own and manage land. Now, it's clear from the latest comments of the Climate Change Committee that a lack of a coherent Scottish agriculture policy, which falls totally within the remit of the Scottish Government, is of serious concern. The Government is also clearly failing on its current peatland restoration targets, and they failed for over 10 years on tree planting targets. If they are going to meet their net zero targets, they'll need to up their game. So, a simple question, Cabinet Secretary. When are you going to be able to meet your tree planting targets?
Cabinet Secretary.
So let me touch upon the issue, first of all, of agriculture, because there is work being taken forward through the Vision for Agriculture, which outlines a range of measures that are going to be taken forward in order to support farming and food production in Scotland, in order to make sure that it's much more sustainable and has a focus on regenerative agriculture. And that's a piece of work which has been taken forward by my colleague, Marie Goujon, at the present time. And I've also already touched upon the issue of peatland restoration and the work we're taking, which we're already seeing the benefits of with a ramping up of capacity within the sector, which is now feeding through into this year's figures. In relation to woodlands generation and new woodlands planting, the member will be aware that 75% of all of the UK's new woodland planting is taking place here in Scotland, which just demonstrates the scale of what we are doing and actually the dearth of ambition and lack of progress across the rest of the UK is 75% of it is taking place in Scotland. And what we want to do is to ramp that up further, and what we are going to do is continue to make investment and to support skill development in these areas in order to allow that progress to continue to be made going forward.
I call Jackie Dunbar to be followed by Mercedes Bialba.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. At this week's NZEC Committee, Emily Nurse of the UK Climate Change Committee highlighted the UK Government's decision to put the Scottish cluster on the reserve list has had a knock-on effect for hitting targets in Scotland. Does the Cabinet Secretary agree that the Scottish cluster, the Acorn CCS and the hydrogen project are important not just for the North East but for the whole of Scotland and our ambitious net zero energy strategy? And can I ask what ongoing discussions the Scottish Government is having with the UK Government about supporting these critical projects?
Cabinet Secretary.
Signing off, so the member raises a very important point, and Emily Nurse is correct in highlighting the critical importance, or what I would describe as the mission-critical nature of the Acorn project and the Scottish cluster to helping to support us in achieving our net zero targets. That's why in the Committee on Climate Change they view negative emission technologies of this nature as being a necessity in order to achieve these targets. And the reality is the failure of the UK government to give it track one status is a betrayal of the people of the North East, and it is a betrayal of those who have actually been committed to taking forward key policy areas in order to achieve climate change within our heavy, energy-intensive industries, which is why we need to stop this dithering and the delay, which is creating uncertainty for the industry and for jobs in the North East and in other parts of Scotland because of the failure of leadership within the UK government over this matter, which is why we continue to press them. I, in recent weeks, have been again in correspondence with Grant Shapps on this very issue, asking for urgency on it. As yet, we haven't had a response that would suggest there is any change in their position on it, but it is a blatant betrayal of the North East of Scotland in particular in failing to take forward this project. It is the most deliverable and the most ambitious in the whole of the UK. It's critical to Scotland meeting its net zero targets and for the rest of the UK, and any further delay is going to cost jobs and it's going to undermine investment and also undermine the progress we can make in meeting our climate change targets.
I call Mercedes Villalba to be followed by Jenny Minto.
The Scottish Government is looking to scale up the rate of peatland restoration by increasing private sector investment through the Peatland Code. Dr. Callum MacLeod, Policy Director at Community Lands Scotland, has warned that this private sector investment could prevent Scottish communities from securing, quote, significant and lasting community benefits from restoration work, end quote. So will the Minister outline what legal protections will be put in place through the upcoming Land Reform Bill to ensure that it's the people of Scotland, not private investors, who benefit from peatland restoration work?
Cabinet Secretary.
Signing Officer, I'm not aware of the individual case that the Member is referring to, but if she wants to pass on information to me, I'm more than content to look into the matter. But I'll also ask my colleague, Mary McCallum, to set out in more detail the exact measures which are being taken within the Land Reform Bill, which will be coming before Parliament, in detailing the response that we are going to be taking in order to help to support peatland restoration and ownership of land in that regard. I hope that's helpful to the Member.
I call Jenny Minto to be followed by Liam MacArthur.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The west of Scotland is home to one of the most important remaining temperate rainforest sites in Europe, which is a key net carbon sink, with my own constituency of Argyll and Bute being home to more than 50% of it. Can the Cabinet Secretary outline what support the Scottish Government is providing to ensure that Scotland's rainforest, of which I'm pleased to say I'm nature champion for, is restored and expanded as a natural solution to the climate emergency?
Cabinet Secretary.
Absolutely, Officer. I think everyone recognises now the importance of dealing with the twin crises of climate change and biodiversity loss, and the outcome from COP15 itself, I think, helps to give a greater focus on the need for us to address the issue of biodiversity loss much more effectively. And that's why we as a government are very much committed to ensuring that our rainforests in Scotland are protected. A project which is to restore Scotland's rainforests has already received over £1.3 million to help to support the control of invasive rhododendrons and also to restore ancient woodland previously planted with non-native trees and to manage the impact of wild deer on these new fragile forest ecosystems. And that's all part of our Nature Restoration Fund, which has this month recommending and funding for three projects to restore the Atlantic rainforest in Western Scotland. So the rainforest will play an important part in helping to support our development of our support for our nature-based solutions in helping to address issues around biodiversity loss in the way in which Jenny Minto has highlighted.
I call Liam MacArthur to be followed by Stuart McMillan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. This really is a bleak assessment of where Scotland is at in terms of its achievement of its climate targets. Lib Dem research suggests that the current rate of progress, it will take 300 years just to insulate fuel poor homes. The Cabinet Secretary talks of, quote, stepping up investment in retrofitting to improve on the £1.8 billion of allocated public funding, but the Government also estimates that it will require £33 billion to achieve this target. Given the UK CCC Chair has said he sees no clear plan for drawing in the remaining private funds needed, where does the Cabinet Secretary expect to get these funds?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, Presiding Officer, the member may be aware that my colleague Patrick Harvey has already taken forward work in order to help to draw in private sector investment to help to support the work that will be necessary to assist with the decarbonisation of domestic premises. But it will also require a different approach to how we deliver heating, which is why helping to support things like heat networks will play an important role in supporting the decarbonisation of a greater number of properties rather than on an individual basis. So that combination of public and private sector investment and also changing the way in which we deliver heating as well will play an important part in contributing towards achieving these targets. And as I've also stated earlier on in response, I think it was to Liam Kerr, we're also going to be bringing forward legislation which will make the statutory provisions for driving forward the changes which will be necessary to install net zero heating systems as we move forward in the years ahead.
Stuart McMillan to be followed by Mark Ruskell.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Would the Cabinet Secretary consider pilot projects of using our rivers and waterways to help move some freight, but with carbon neutral solutions at either end to actually help reduce the impact on the environment?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I think we need to look at all alternative methods for transportation, and there is presently a modal shift grant which operators can have access to for freight and for freight by rail and also coastal waters, which can be accessed in order to support alternative uses. If I recall correctly, I think we provide grant to support the transportation of wood from the Argyll Peninsula into Troon Harbour, which is then used for making various wood products in order to remove the freight from the main road network itself. So there are funds which are there to help to support that type of transition, whether it be in coastal waters or in rail, to get freight off our roads.
Mark Ruskell to be followed by Maurice Golden.
Can I welcome the tone of the Cabinet Secretary's statement this afternoon, his desire for a much more credible plan, and also his desire to try and at least get a consensus in this Parliament on the really hard choices we're going to have to make if we're to get any close to meeting these targets. The Mossmorran complex in Fife remains the third largest climate polluter in Scotland, and it's unthinkable that we could meet climate targets without slashing the plant's emissions. But that has to be achieved in a way that leaves no workers behind. So can I ask the Cabinet Secretary if he agrees that we now need a site-specific just transition plan for Mossmorran?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I am aware of the work and the issues of concern which the member has raised previously on the issue of Mossmorran. And I do believe that the approach that we have taken within the Grangemouth Future Industry Board is a method that could also, and an approach that could also be used in Mossmorran in helping to shape how some of our major industrial clusters can be reshaped in a way that meet our climate change ambitions, but also help to deliver a just transition. And some of the work which we're taking forward now through the Grangemouth Future Industry Board, through the just transition plans which are being developed for the sites and also for the sectors, could equally be applied to Mossmorran. And I'm certainly more than happy to engage with the member in looking at how we can support that moving forward.
I call Maurice Golden to be followed by John Mason.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Scotland was ranked worst of all the countries surveyed in the recent circularity gap reports. Our economy is just 1.3% circular, well below the global average of 8.6%. I know the Cabinet Secretary was keen to talk up various plans and projects, but the reality is the SNP have effectively made no progress in creating the sustainable economy we need to reach net zero. Adding to the problem, the Circular Economy Bill consultation was both flawed and unambitious. So does the Cabinet Secretary accept the need for urgent action to deliver a circular economy?
Cabinet Secretary.
I do, Presiding Officer, which is why we are taking actions like introducing the deposit return scheme, and also why we're also going to be bringing forward a very ambitious circular economy bill, which will help to drive forward that change in the years ahead.
And John Mason.
Thank you. I personally believe that it's very important Scotland takes an international approach when it comes to climate change, and we have a responsibility especially for developing countries. Can the Cabinet Secretary say anything about loss and damage, and particular in relation to COP27?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, there has been painfully slow progress in addressing the issue of of loss and damage, an issue which was covered in the recent debate on COP27 in this Parliament. At COP27, there has been more progress than has been the case in previous years. Clearly, we have taken very clear leadership action at COP26, which has helped to be a catalyst for further investment from other countries. We're now seeing further progress being made, where there were some positive outcomes around loss and damage from COP27, but we need to see much more, because the reality is that very often the people and the communities and the countries which are experiencing the greatest brunt and the negative impact of the climate change that is already locked into our climate are those who have contributed the least to creating a climate change as well, which is why we all have a collective responsibility to support them in meeting the challenges which they face.
Thank you. That concludes the ministerial statement. We now move on to the next item of business, which is decision time. But there are no questions to be put as a result of today's business, so I'd like to take this opportunity to wish all members and all staff in Parliament a very happy and peaceful Christmas. And that concludes decision time. But we'll now move on to members' business.